Hello and a very warm welcome to today's session brought to you by Team Grade Up. I hope you all are doing really well. Let's very quickly kickstart today's session. And today's session is the first part that we're having on Canadian writers. Today will be a very important brief session which will acquaint you about the various themes related to Canadian literature. It'll also tell you some very important Canadian writers that we definitely have to do in greater detail. And of course, the most important in detail analysis, we'll take it up in the next lecture, or if time permits, we'll take it up in today's lecture itself. Now, whenever you're talking about Canadian writers, a lot of universities actually have separate courses on Canadian writers. You have a separate, new literature in English manuals that are developed for Canadian writers. And Canadian writing is one of the first ever multicultural. Yes, you need to remember this, that, you know, the Multicultural Act was the first important act that was introduced primarily in Canada. Of course, we consider America to be a multicultural nation, but it was Canada which got the Multicultural Act for the very first time. And it said that, you know, we are a multicultural mosaic, not a melting pot. Melting pot means that, you know, you're trying to give up your features and then you're trying to absorb the other features. You're melting yourself, you're giving away yourself. But a mosaic, a multicultural mosaic, so Canada called itself as a multicultural mosaic. That means that each and every individual was actually retaining their own identity. And therefore, America is considered to be a melting pot, but Canada is considered to be a salad bowl, a melting pot, right, where you are losing some parts of your identity in order to become a part of the larger identity that you're having. But when we talk about Canada is telling you that no, it's a salad, it's just a salad, right? Just like in a salad, you know, where is the cucumber, you know, where is the radish, where is the carrot, you're able to differentiate where are the onions kept. So it is, Canada is using a salad bowl metaphor, it is using a salad bowl metaphor. So that is also very important. It is one of the first important nations to adopt a two-language official policy. So both English and French are the official languages of Canada. And what is very important is that, you know, after Russia, Canada is the second largest country that we're talking about across the world, but still it is having the population as limited as Ethiopia. So even though whenever we talk about Canada, you must always remember that whenever we speak about Canada, we are talking about an elephantine. This is what critics say. We are talking about an elephantine geography. It is the world's second largest country after Russia. It is the world's second largest country that we are having. Second largest country after Russia. But the population is as small as that of Ethiopia. And that is also because when you're talking about Canada, Canada is having many places which have temperatures which can almost give competition to the frigid areas like Antarctic and Arctic. So it is very, very cold, and therefore, like, you know, majority of the population that you have is actually concentrated on a very coastal region. They're concentrated on a coastal region. So these are some things that you have to definitely keep in mind. I hope the audio is absolutely clear and you're able to see the presentation. Yes, I just checked it up at my end also. I will put myself on mute so that there is no disturbance whatsoever. So here, very, very quickly, we will of course be analyzing Canadian writings, and this lecture and another lecture that we'll have, if in case need be, we will of course schedule another session. But remember, Canadian writers are also part of your world literature. So these are certain things that you definitely have to keep in mind. There's Sana, there's Rachna, there's Devjani. Devjani, don't worry. See, NET itself is an exam which helps you to understand what all portions you've not touched in literature, what are some areas that you have to focus on. And I'm really glad that even after you're saying that, you know, you've been trying for it for the past 2 years, so I'm glad that you don't have this quitting mentality, which will take you very far. Because a lot of us give up things very easily. okay, fine, we're not able to clear this exam, so let's stop preparing for this exam. But it looks, by the looks of it, you haven't really done that. So kudos to you for that. And this is the only spirit that you require to ace this exam, okay? So don't worry about it at all. There's Ilan, there's Niji, there's Priyanka, there's Rupa, there's Moon Moon, there's Gurpreet, there's Shubhi, Nayana. We will do that. Shubhi, I will recommend, don't worry about that. Let's look at the Grade Up Studio platform. How many of you have joined in? Sukiti, good evening. Hi, Sushmita. Hi, Prashant. Hi, Kanchan. Hi, Emma. Emma, you've joined on both the platforms or what? Okay, maybe. Hi, Rapia. Yes, I'm doing well. Thank you so much for asking. Hi, Munmun. Hi, Kohu. Hi, Madhu. Hi, Prashant. Rabia Singh, can you repeat about the Elephantine geography? Yes. So critics say that, you know, when you're talking about Canada is, we'll repeat all these points again. Canada is the second largest, like India is the seventh largest country in this world. So we've got the first largest is China, and then the second largest is Canada. But still, Canada is having a population which is as small as Ethiopia. And that is the reason you see that a lot of time Canada encourages immigrants to come and stay, because they want their population to increase, because there's a very limited population in comparison to the vast geography that they are having. But a lot of geography is also something that is unused because it's very cold out there. Okay, so Canada, you need to remember certain thing. What are the things? That Canada is multicultural mosaic, not a melting pot. Everyone can retain their own cultural identity. It was the first ever nation to introduce the Multicultural Act. The second point is that it has this elephantine geography, but the population is as limited as Ethiopia. And that is the reason, and that too is concentrated on the border of America. The third point that you have to remember is that Canada had not only experienced British colonialism and French colonialism, it has also experienced America's neo-colonialism. So the southern, this is Canada and this is United States of America. The southern neighbor of Canada has always exerted pressure, has always exerted influence on Canada, and that becomes an example of neo-colonialism. We will discuss all these pointers in greater detail, so you don't have to worry at all about it. Let's very quickly continue and look at it. So today you will have, the agenda is, we will look at Canadian writings, and before that we'll have a rapid fire quiz. Okay, so prior to that, what will you have? Prior to that, you will have a rapid fire quiz. So let's very quickly get started, and like I said, it's rapid fire. We'll not be taking a lot of time because today is not a marathon session. Okay, this is the first question, and today also the questions are fairly decent. But do remember that these are important questions from the perspective of your upcoming exams, like UPPCS, GIC exam, or when you're talking about the RPSC paper or the GATE paper. These are certain questions that you can expect in those exams as well. The term Fleshly School of Poetry is associated with, very, very quickly, please answer this question. Gurpreet is saying Canada is a mini Punjab. Okay, yes, that is true. So I watched this this channel, Gurpreet, which is called Pitara, and so a lot of two or three of the people that I know in Canada, they also watch the same thing. They also watch Pitara there. Okay, yes. So what is the correct answer here? Okay, very, very quickly, what is the right answer? So, Shalu has given the answer. Swati has given the answer. Lidji has given the answer. Let's just see at the classroom platform how many of you have answered it correctly. Sukirti is right. Rabia is right. Jamila, it's not images. Prashant is absolutely right. Good evening, Vandana. Kanchan, Bilawat, Madhu. Itasa has also given the right answer. Very good, Itasa. Siani has also given the right answer. Very good, Siani. Geeta. Nargis, why not sure? V is absolutely the correct answer. Kuhu has also given the right answer. Hi, Anki. Hi, Reno. Good evening. Okay. Maybe, Ima, I thought that I read your name over there also. Okay. So, great. Fantastic. All of you are absolutely right. So, what had happened was that D.G. Rossetti's poetry was read by Robert Buchanan. And Robert Buchanan said that this is very scandalous. It's very obscene. It is trying to privilege the senses. It's very sensual in nature. And the Victorian society was a society which was absolutely conservative in its outlook. And they considered these writings to be, in a way, obscene, and therefore Robert Buchanan called the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood as the fleshly school of poetry. The Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhoods were the fleshly school of poets. Chartist movement was a working class movement, and this working class movement was actually being represented in the condition of England novels. There were these novels called the condition of, right, the condition of England novels, and the condition of England novels represented the Chartist movement, which was a working class movement, almost very, very active during the 1840s, right? So that is, of course, their symbolism is a precursor to your modernism, and imagism is, of course, telling you about brevity, propagated by Ezra Pound. Ezra Pound, who said that poetry is a kind of mathematics. Poetry is a kind of mathematics, but your Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood is absolutely the correct answer that you have to keep in mind. So whenever you talk about Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, remember that they are painter poets, and this is a very important category for your upcoming exams. They are painter poets, sorry. That means that if, for example, the Pre-Raphaelite group of poets, one of them was making a painting, the other would write a poem on that. Or they would write a poem on the work that they have actually presented, the poetry that they have actually presented. Right. So this is something that you have to keep in mind, that when we are talking about Pre-Raphaelite school of poetry, they are painter poets. They are poets who are looking at going before the time of Raphael. What was happening is that, you know, people had started focusing on photographic paintings. So, for example, the way that you're looking right now, I will pick you in the same manner and I will represent your work. Now, this kind of painting for people who were belonging to the Pre-Raphaelite school of poetry was not the correct type of writing, or, like, you know, the correct type of making poetry. So what did they finally come up with? They finally came up with this idea that let's go back to the period before Raphael, where people were looking at how is a work of art, having an impact on your senses. What sort of an impact is the work of art having on your senses? That became important. So Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood were people who were more keen, rather than a photographic image, they were more interested in the impact that a work of art had on your senses. What reaction did it invoke? What was the impact that was there? Right, so these were painter poets that we had. These painter poets were, of course, breaking with tradition. They are termed as fleshly school of poets by Robert Buchanan. So who's calling them? Robert Buchanan. This is, again, a very common set exam question, that who calls them the fleshly school of poets? The fleshly school of poets was a charge. It was a criticism. It was a criticism. And in its defense, what happened was the Rossettis said, no, we are not fleshly school of poets. We are rather the stealthy school of poetry. We are stealthily trying to capture what things you are missing out on. We are trying to capture all the details that you people are trying to miss out on, right? So those are things that you have to keep in mind, right? Those are things which become important. So sorry. I hope, yeah, I'm audible. Okay, I couldn't see the image. That's the reason. So Robert Buchanan was trying to criticize them. Robert Buchanan was saying that your kind of poetry, right, the poetry that you're representing is something which is slightly obscene, and therefore calling it fleshly school of poetry. So clearly in 1871, Robert Buchanan, in the essay called The Fleshly School of Poets, he criticized the indecencies. He criticized the indecency, and D.J. Rossetti wrote an essay of self defense called the stealthy school of criticism. So these are both the terms that are given to the painter poets. These are a group of poets in the Victorian society. They're very important. D.G. Rossetti, William Morris, Christina Rossetti, John Ruskin, all of these people, you know, you would see, you get questions on all of them, right? Even though John Ruskin is a different part altogether, but you get questions on William Morris, you get questions on D.G. Rossetti, you get questions on Christina Rossetti, The Goblin Market. So here, and D.J. Rossetti, The Blessed Damsel. So you must remember that whenever you talk about your Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, they are a very important topic that you have to cover in detail. I'll hide myself so that you can see that how Buchanan gave an attack in 1871, and we had D.J. Rossetti reacting to that particular comment by writing The Stealthy School of Criticism. So Fleshly School of Poetry, Painter Poet, Stealthy School of Criticism. These are three terms that are associated with your Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, who are going back to the period before Raphael to capture your impact, what impact you had on your senses when you looked at something. Rather than photographically capturing something, what impact that thing is having on you, that is something that these people were trying to cover and look at, right? And these people were, of course, very devoted to details, because obviously they were painter poets. As painters, you're very specifically looking at details. What color, what shade, what sort of a tone do you have to use? So that is, of course, there. Let's come on to the next question in your rapid fire quiz today. Miracle plays are based on the lives of. Everyone should get this correctly. Everyone, very, very quickly, please tell us what is the correct answer. Should be the details about the course, as far as what is the duration, all the plan is there at the Grade Up Studio. You can take a look at the plan that is being followed for the classes. Absolutely right. Absolutely right. Very good. So remember when we were talking about the development of English literature, or a broad overview of English literature, what did we talk about? We spoke about this very important point. And what is this very important point? This very important point is that first you have liturgical drama. Classroom students, I hope you're able to remember this. First we have liturgical drama. This liturgical drama is written by the clergy. This liturgical drama is performed by the clergy. This liturgical drama that we are having is a drama that is being played out, enacted within the church premises. And it is written in Latin. It is written in Latin. So written by the clergy, performed by the clergy, performed inside the church, and written in Latin. Thereafter, we see that people are moving away, and then you have the development of your mystery cycles. These mystery cycles are being performed at different places, and that's the reason you have the Corpus Christi cycle, and you have the York cycle, the Wakefield cycle, because these are the places where these people are performing. And that is where we said that in France, you have My B, that means mystery cycles based on the lives of the Bible, the incidents from the Bible that have taken place. And the miracle plays are dealing with the lives of the saints. The miracle plays are dealing with the lives of the saints, as most of you have answered it correctly. And they're also talking about the miracles that were being performed. So these are aspects that are there in the development of liturgical drama. Let's see how many of you got it right at the classroom platform also. Excellent. Most of you have got it right. So all the way, I think, fantastic. Very good. Okay. Okay, this was a question asked. Sneha is asking, what is fleshly? Fleshly is basically related to the senses part, right? For example, if you're very hungry and if you have food immediately, you feel satiated, you feel very happy, you're not very irritated then when you've had food, right? So fleshly is something that is appealing to the body, that is appealing to the body, that's appealing to the appetite. Okay, so do remember that. Taslima is asking, was there any reason for starting the Fleshly School of Poetry? So basically, it's the Pre-Raphaelite poetry. So people like D.J. Rossetti, people like Christina Rossetti, William Morris, these people were people who were not happy with the photographic representation of paintings. And they wanted to go to a different style where you were not just capturing what you could see. You were actually capturing what you could feel after looking at something. So that was the major reason they were not very happy with the developments that were taking place. Okay, Taslima, that was the reason. Yes, of course, Rabia, that's true. So Rachna, Mauryam, Sushmita, Kuhu, Itasha, Ima, very good, very good. Maitri, Rabia, Geeta, Siani, Abhi, Anki, all of you have answered it correctly. Madhu, Sonia, Jamila, Moriam, very good, very good. I think most of you have answered it correctly. All of you have given the right answer. Okay, there are so many of you. Okay, fantastic. So that means all of you have started studying and paying attention in class. So that is great. So Miracle plays, again, a medieval dramatic form in which we see that stories from the Bible, the biblical story. And remember, the development of the Bible is a very important topic for you from the examination perspective. The development of Bible, particularly the development of English Bible, the various translations of the Bibles that are available. The Vulgate's Bible, the Coverdale's Bible, the Tyndale's Bible, right? So all those things are extremely crucial and you must remember that. And these plays, miracle plays, are dealing with the story or the life of a saint. Or they are telling you about a miracle, something that is going against nature. Something that is going against nature. I will hide myself so that you can see it completely. Something that goes against nature, that is what is being depicted in these plays, right? That is what is getting depicted in these plays. Both mystery plays and miracle plays are leading finally to the secularization of drama. Both of them are leading to the secularization of drama. And finally, what do we see? Finally, we see that there is a development of your Elizabethan drama. There is the development of your Elizabethan drama. This is a thing that you have to remember. Very important, these romantic non-fiction writers or romantic prose writers are also very crucial from the examination point of view, because you get questions coming from the romantic prose writing tradition as well. You get questions that come from prose writings as well. So Edmund Burke denounced the French Revolution in which of the following works? So Edmund Burke said that, you know, French Revolution is just creating anarchy. French Revolution is merely creating chaos. French Revolution is merely responsible for pandemonium. And everyone must stop supporting the revolution in France. So which is the book in which he tries to denounce his views? Which are related to, which are against the French Revolution particularly. Very good. Most of you have got it right over here. Let's even look at the classroom platform. How many of you have got the right answer? Very good, Maitri, Kuhu, Rabia, Brinda, Geeta. Geeta, bache, it's not A. It is not political philosophy. It is not political philosophy. And neither is it political inquiry, Madhu. Okay, bache, that is not the right answer. Jamila, no. That is not the right answer. Saurabh, no. Sonia, no, bache. Most of you have answered political philosophy, but it's actually Reflections on the Revolution in France. Reflections on the Revolution in France is the correct answer. What is the correct answer? The correct answer is Reflections on the Revolution in France. This is the complete title of Reflection. Revolution in France. Had, like, you know, the examiner given you the complete title, then obviously you would have marked this as the correct answer. But do remember, yes, Gurpreet, absolutely. Gurpreet from the YouTube platform is absolutely right that how Edmund Burke had this nasty relationship with the feminist Mary Wollstonecraft. Burke refused to give proper citizenship to women, whereas Mary Wollstonecraft was fuming with anger. She said, how can you deprive your views on women are something that are completely things that Mary Wollstonecraft was not agreeing with him at all on, right? So she had different perspectives about the role of women in the society and the role that women played overall. So that is, of course, there. That is something that you have to keep in mind. So Edmund Burke, born in Dublin to a middle-class family, half Protestant, half Catholic, and his views are extremely crucial and they form a very important backbone of prose fiction during the Romantic period. Okay, so do keep that in mind. Edmund Burke having the tussle also with Mary Wollstonecraft. The line, a man can be destroyed but not defeated. A man can be destroyed but not defeated. You can destroy me, but you can never defeat me. Right? These are very, very popular lines. They celebrate a spirit that is extremely important. Where are these lines taken from? About biblical stories are stories from the Bible. They are the stories from the Bible. Okay. Very, very quickly, what is the right answer here? Yes, classroom students, very good, very good. Sangeeta, no, A is not the right answer, but Kuhu, Moriam, Taslima, very nice. Prashant, Jamila, Nargis, Yes, Ima, no, don't ask a question. You're absolutely going right. Amina, Rabia, Sonia, Bilawat, Anki, Sukirti, Madhu. Sushmita Singh, please repeat about Mary Wollstonecraft. So Sushmita, Mary Wollstonecraft was talking about, she was married to William Godwin, and you know, she could see that William Godwin, Edmund Burke, these people had good notions about equality for only men. But what about women? They were ignoring women. And she was massively dissatisfied. She would have arguments with people like Edmund Burke that why do you ignore the category of women? Why do you not include the category of women? Why are they invisible for you? Why are women not visible for you? That was her question that she would ask. That why on earth were women not being seen by all of you, whereas they should be seen by all of you? Right. So that was a major point. That was a major concern that she had always. And that is the reason there was a divide between what Mary Wollstonecraft was saying and what Edmund Burke was saying. And both of them were replying to each other as well. All right. Most of you have answered this absolutely right. Right. So the correct answer is The Old Man and the Sea by Ernest Hemingway. Ernest Hemingway committed suicide because he wanted to preserve his strength. He did not want to die. He did not want to get old and die. So therefore, he killed himself. He committed suicide. So a lot of your famous novelists who commit suicide are also important for you. A lot of your very famous novelists who, yes, of course, A.B., he won the Nobel Prize as well. And Ernest Hemingway is known for, there is one question that is asked that, you know, Hemingway says that the entire American literature emerges from one book, and that is The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn by Mark Twain, because that book talks about colloquialism, that book talks about serious issues, that book is having a clearly defined plot and a subplot, and it deals with issues that are being discussed by other people as well. Right. And additionally, what we have to remember, Ernest Hemingway is very famous for his iceberg technique. He is writing in an iceberg technique format. What is this iceberg technique? Iceberg technique is just like, you know, you have this iceberg, you can only see the tip of the iceberg. But deep inside, the iceberg is very big. Deep inside, the iceberg is extremely big. Now, what you have to remember over here, you have to remember over here that the tip of the iceberg looks very simple, but then there is a lot of depth. And that is the same technique that Hemingway follows. And this is a technique that even, like, you know, Blake follows, but you don't call it iceberg technique. But Hemingway's technique is called iceberg technique because of the fact that, you know, he's writing simple, using simple language, but the meaning is very deep that he's trying to convey. In the very simple story, The Old Man and the Sea, he is very successful in letting people know about the true spirit of America. That the true spirit of America lies in never quitting. The true spirit of America lies in never stop trying. Never ever stop trying. Always keep on trying. Never quit at all whatsoever. You will come close to your dream. So that is, of course, there that we have to keep in mind. Which of the following is not a play by Tennessee Williams? Tennessee Williams, again, a very important writer that is a kind of a sort of a must read writer. Now, even if you were not aware about the works, you can actually remember that The Zoo Story is a work written by Edward Albee. The Zoo Story is a work written by Edward Albee, who has written Your Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, right? Edward Albee is writing Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, and he's also writing The Zoo Story. So this is the odd one out, which has not been written. This is the odd one out, which has not been written by Tennessee Williams. Tennessee Williams, otherwise a very important writer, playwright, telling us about the themes of escapism, the modern themes that are plaguing people around. So do remember that. So Edward Albee's play, The Zoo Story, is the one that is not written by by Tennessee Williams. So Tennessee Williams was actually, this is a very fascinating point, that he grew up in a family wherein a lot of women members were there. And therefore, in his plays, you see a very sympathetic portrayal of women. because he was born and raised in a family where women were there, women were respected, and therefore we can easily see that, you know, in his works, we are able to easily see in his works this entire spirit where women are complimented, where women are in the sense, not complimented in the sense that, you know, they're praised, complimented in the sense that, you know, whatever activities they're doing, they're well justified activities, that you can see that why the women are acting in a particular way, there is a proper justification, just like Euripides. Euripides during the classical time was doing the same thing. Euripides during the classical time was also trying to give a proper representation of women in works like Medea. Medea kills her children, but we never hate her in Euripides' play. Because we are told that she was a victim of sexual jealousy. We were told that she was a victim of the fact that she abandoned her father for the sake of Jason, but still she was the one who was betrayed. Then the Trojan women powerfully, sympathetically telling you about the plight of women, the oikos that is there. So even Euripides, for example, because of the fact that he was coming, right, because of the fact that he was coming from a family where women were, of course, ruling and calling the cards. So he was definitely having these sympathetic opinions. But Tennessee Williams is a must-read writer, and we must remember him. We've been talking about for the past 3 days, Wolstoinka, and we spoke yesterday in the previous lecture that how Wolstoinka is replying when he's asked this question that what are your views on negritude, and he says a tiger never proclaims his tigritude. He is never wanting to say his tigritude. He will never assert himself, right? He will never ever assert himself. So that is, of course, there. The term negritude was coined by, who was the person who coined the term negritude? Very good, very good. Yes, ABC Shan, all those are the right ones. Okay, so do keep that in mind. Wonderful. Okay, all right, let's very, very quickly take a look at your answers at the classroom platform also. Yes, Geeta, that's right. Taslima has got it right. Bilawat has got it right. Geeta. Bacha, Rachna, it's not A. Fano and Homi Baba. Fano is telling you about the cultural impact, the psychological impact of colonialism, that how white people, black men have started behaving like white men. So he's talking about black skins, white masks, that we have black skins, brown skins, but we've started behaving like the whites. And Homi Baba is another post-colonial critic, but not talking about negritude. Okay, so do remember that. But and Saurav, it's not Gugiwa Thiong'o and Wolstoinka. Some of you have answered it correctly. Poonam is right. Nargis is right. Priya is right. Okay, Suketi is right. Taslima is right. Nargis is right. Sushmita is right. Prashant, you're wrong. Maitri, you are right. Sonia, you are right. Very good, Priya. Priya is right again. Priya, I think, maybe you made it. Okay, Sangeeta is right. So some of you got it right on the classroom platform, but some of you haven't. Please remember, it is I am Cesare. This is typo error. This is I am Cesare and Leupold Signor. I am Cesare and Leupold Signor. Today, if you have time, what you can do is, for some of you who are following Pramod K. Nair, Pramod K. Nair, there is a chapter in your book on literary theory that is called Critical Race Theory. Today, just try and read that chapter once. Okay, today, just try, if you have time, to read that chapter in the book of Pramod K. Nair, the theory book of Pramod K. Nair, which is, I think, chapter 10 or 9, which is on critical race theory. So just read the critical race theory part. It'll really help you a lot. This is a very important question, has been asked in your NET exams 2 times. The same question almost, okay? Fanny Burney's Evelina is about. So Fanny Burney's Evelina, see the early types of novels and the novels that were written by women writers like Fanny Burney, Jane Austen. These are all important for you. These are all crucial from your examination point of view. And Fanny Burney's Evelina is telling you about a young lady's entry into English fashionable society. Okay, so into English fashionable society, it's a young lady's entry into the English fashionable society. We've got Pygmalion also by G.B. Shaw, which tells you how there is, like, you know, how Eliza Doolittle is getting transformed to fit the elite society, the fashionable society. So the fashionable society is getting discussed in all centuries, in the 19th century, in the 20th century, the aristocracy, how women have to behave in the society. What is the role that is played by women? These are all concerns that are getting depicted. Okay, the unexpurged, the unexpurgated text of Lady Chatterley's Lover was published after obscenity trial in the unexpurged, the unexpurgated text of Lady Chatterley's Lover was published after the obscenity trial in which year? So Lady Chatterley's Lover was considered to be inappropriate and therefore it faced trials. But after the obscenity trials, it was published. What was the year when it was published? What was the year when it was published? Very good, very good. Some of you, Shalu has answered it correctly. Let's see the classroom platform. How many of you have answered it correctly? See, D.H. Lawrence is writing novels of blood. D.H. Lawrence is writing novels such as Sons and Lovers. And his novels are must-read novels. He's one of the founding members of modernism. And you can't afford to go and sit for your exams without having read these modernist patriarchs like E.M. Forster, Joseph Conrad, Virginia Woolf, James Joyce, D.H. Lawrence. These are very important novelists that you have to definitely do before and do properly before you sit for the final exam. Okay, so yes, most of you have got that right. So it is 1960, that is the correct answer. After 1960, some of you got it right, so that is there was the obscenity trials, and Lawrence is associated with the novels of blood. And remember, I told you once earlier also that Amit Chowdhury, who's written A Brave New World, is not just translating but evaluating the poetry of D.H. Lawrence, which no one else was doing. He's trying to evaluate the poetry of D.H. Lawrence. One of the last questions, the term American Renaissance was first used by, this term that we are having, American Renaissance, it was first used by, who was the person who had used this for the first time? Very, very quickly, please tell me what is the right answer so that we can go ahead. Yes, ABZ Shan, that is true. Yeah, AF, right. That was also the subtitle of Evelina. That's the reason I'm telling you that the same question, they've not even changed it a little, but it's come twice in your paper for Evelina. Okay, yes. So here, some of you have answered A, some of you have answered C. So C is absolutely the correct answer. Let's see on the classroom platform how many of you have managed to answer. Jamila is right. Madhu is absolutely right. Then there is Rabia who is right. Taslima is right. Kuhu, Saurav, very good. Ima, all of you, I can see most of you have got it right. Okay, so here the term American Renaissance, which is used for mentioning about these five American Renaissance writers, right, who are trying to build a new form of writing. They're inaugurating a new form of writing in American literature. And this particular term was actually coined by F.O. Matheson. Matheson is the one who's coining the term American Renaissance. He tells us that the writings of Henry David Thoreau in the form of Civil Disobedience, and of course, like, you know, so sorry, Civil Disobedience, Walden, which is there, the writings of Emerson, the writings of Hawthorne, as well as Whitman were categorized as a part of American Renaissance. Walt Whitman, because he was getting vers libre, he was getting free verse in English. Now let's very quickly come on to the main topic for discussion today. You can, like, you know, take a quick stretch your arms a little, drink water, drink a sip of coffee if you want to. Now very quickly, let's come on to Canadian writers and Canadian literature. Then the next 5 to 10 minutes, I will briefly walk you through what are some of the central themes in Canadian writings, what are some of the most important Canadian writers that you have to look into from your examination point of view. And tomorrow we will look at some others also, and we'll revise more details also about these Canadian writers. So let's very, very quickly get started. Now, whenever you talk about the history of Canada, the history of Canada is the history of colonialism. The history of Canada is the history of colonialism. And whenever we talk about the history of colonialism, there was a systematic destruction of the Aboriginal population. What was there? Because of technological mind. Remember in the yesterday's session on post-colonialism, we said in Peru, in Zimbabwe, what were they doing? They decimated the population. They killed people. They decimated the population and they killed people completely. So whenever we talk about, they also share the history of British being a British colony. They were also member state of the Commonwealth. Canada gained its independence on 1st July 1867. That is when they were able to get independence from Great Britain. But independence, it was of course achieved, but then there were problems because, like I told you, that even though Canada is the second largest country, but it is having the population which is very thinly populated. That is because of the climate. So there were natural challenges. There were challenges of wilderness. There were challenges of geography which Canada had to endure. And clearly we're able to see that the two founding nations who contributed to the development of written culture, because otherwise the originals had orature. Otherwise the culture of the natives was passed on by orature. Orature is a very significant category when you talk about post-colonialism. Orature basically means oral narratives. What do we mean by orators? Orators basically are your oral narratives. These are your oral narratives that you are using. These are your oral narratives that you're using. Right. This led to a lot of unrest. This led to a lot of unrest. People were very, very unhappy. But do remember that you also have this first important multicultural country that is coming about, people from across the world coming together and settling in Canada and forming the Canadian identity. Now, Canada was very clear that America was trying to engage in the process of neocolonialism. America was engaging in the process of neocolonialism. Canada has always tried to move away from the identification from being part of America itself, or from being considered that they are trying to be run by the American regime only. But yes, clearly there is a case of psychological colonialism. The leaders are definitely affected by the American politics. So clearly when you talk about countries like Ireland, when you talk about countries like Scotland, when you talk about, or Scotland is still a part of Britain, but in case if this year it becomes a different country altogether, or when we talk about when we are talking about Canada, these are all countries that are experiencing psychological colonialism. There is psychological colonialism. That means, what does psychological colonialism means? You have managed to control their minds, and you have managed to make them believe that they are inferior. So clearly they aren't Americans, but they are being ruled, governed, and that is a new form of neocolonialism that is seen. There is a crisis of identity because people are coming from all walks of life. People are coming from across the borders. People are coming almost from everywhere, and then they are settling up. So it is a multicultural society, and that is the reason, one of the first society in which they had declared that there will be two important languages. So English and French both became the two important languages here in Canada. Okay. So that is of course there. Yes, Shalu, of course, there is some sort of hegemony that is operating. There is hegemony, there is control, because they are politically powerful. If I do not agree to them, I will have America's crazy. It might just bombard me. And they do that for places which are far ahead. And here I'm like, you know, right in the lap of America, because I'm so closely connected with America, to America. So that is, of course, the thing that you have to keep in mind, that we're getting overshadowed by America. Canada was the world's first officially multicultural nation, the Multiculturalism Act. It was one of the first few nations to declare that they are a multicultural society, that they are a pluralistic society, that they are a society not with a single religion or a single important dominant, you could say, dominant identity that was there for everyone. ABC Shan is saying, can we say that globalization is a complete phase of neo-colonialism or colonialism? Yes, according to many people, that is what it is. And that's the reason you will hear them say that finally the products that you buy, if they are manufactured abroad or if their companies are abroad, you're selling the profit there. So that is running their GDP and not our GDP. So many people say that, yes, it is a kind of an economic control. But do remember that originally also the colonizers had come because of capitalistic issues. Originally also the colonizers had actually come because of capitalistic issues, as we've seen previously also. Alright, so it is described as a cultural mosaic, not as a cultural melting pot. Melting pot basically means that I am losing my own identity to become a part of another person's identity. Officially, it is bilingual. There are more than 65 native languages that are spoken. And clearly, we can see that they are having easy immigration laws to encourage people to become a part of the ever-growing population that they want, which is not growing at a very rapid pace in Canada. Okay, now when you talk about, whenever we are discussing about Canadian writers, I will of course try to either, keep myself a little, 1 second. So that you'll all be able to see the screen properly. That is my ultimate agenda. Oh, but this is hiding me, right? Okay. Yes. So just for this particular part, I'm doing this. Now, if you look at this particular part, you will be able to see that whenever we are talking about the crisis of identity, if someone is dominating me, if someone is controlling me every now and then, if someone is telling me do this, do that, don't do this, don't do that, I will have a crisis of identity. I will have a crisis of identity. American influence was considered to be a major problem, a major roadblock. American influence was considered to be a major roadblock for many people. They considered American, they considered American influence to be something that was curtailing their power to act, that was not helping them take their own decisions, that always dependent. See, for example, if you're hungry, okay, one thing is that you go to the fridge and you get whatever you want to eat. And the other thing is that, you're cribbing, oh, mama has come late, or oh, papa has not come back from work. Now, what will I eat? Why can't they come on time? So here, when you're talking about, here, when we are discussing about, Canadian identity, the American influence was something that everyone wanted to get out of. Now, here we could clearly see that majority of the Canadians actually lived within 160 kilometer of the US border. Majority of the citizens were actually living 1 kilometer of the US border. All right, so that is of course there, but still, people like writers who were very obsessed with regaining the Canadian art and voice, that they were certainly very particular that America's influence has to be undone. There is a crisis of identity. So it is facing crisis of identity. America is ruling them indirectly or directly, and that is an example of neocolonialism. Okay, now here when you talk about what are some common themes, what are some important common themes that we are able to see, what are some important common themes that we are able to identify, what are some common themes that we are able to see and look at whenever we talk about these Canadian novelists. So the most important themes that we have, of course, is nature. The idea of nature is something which is central to Canadian writers. You see that most of them are talking about the elements of nature. They are telling you about how Canada is hostile when it comes to climate. And particularly in the pre-modern era of colonization. In the pre-modern era of colonization, clearly we're able to see that Canada was suffering, from this entire position that how to represent its own nature. So clearly we're able to see that some common themes in Canadian writing is the representation of Canada's literature, the representation of Canada's nature. So, for example, we have Gary Paulsen's Hatchet or Farley Mowat's Lost in the Barrens. So, these are all examples, you could say, of how nature played a central role in Canadian writings. Nature played a very important role in Canadian writings. Yes, you can say that. So, nature, of course, played a very, very dominant role. That is something that you have to obviously keep in mind. I will just change this because otherwise it's difficult for me to sit. So here is a point that you all must remember, that whenever we talk about Canadian writings are looking at some common themes like nature. There is a pioneer experience. People who are entering Canada, what is their experience? Are they able to find the journey arduous? Are they finding the journey to be difficult? Are they not having adequate support? Is the police hitting hard on them? Police in the sense whenever the natives were trying to settle, then how were the aboriginals, not the natives, but the colonizers were trying to settle, then were the natives hard? James Fenimore Cooper, for example, in American literature, talks about the frontier resistance novels. So the pioneer experience, how were people settling? Were people finding it very hard because Canada was a different nation altogether? It was a nation that was, of course, talking about wilderness. Right. So clearly you can see that pioneer experience, the early settlement of Canada, was cruel and unforgiving. It was very hard work. It was a very, very hard, arduous journey to work, right, in order to settle there. Working land had to be inhabited. There were many historical fiction and non-fictional novels that talk about colonialism in Canada. Right. So clearly you are able to see that the early settlement, the issues that they were having, this is something that captures even by James Fenimore Cooper. And James Fenimore Cooper was also writing frontier novels. They were trying to protect their nations from the onslaught of the people who were trying to colonize it. Right? Or they were trying to favor either the France or the British government by taking sides so that one of their favorite could lead. So these are certain things that you have to keep in mind that are crucial for our understanding of Canada's writings. Now, whenever you talk about Canada, you must understand that Canada was a nation which was also having something which is called as the garrison mentality. Why did I introduce this term right now? Because now you are clear that the pioneers' experience was telling you that it was a tough journey and America exerted its influence. Therefore, these people decided to create walls that will isolate them from the outside world. Therefore, they divided to create a wall against themselves so that they could isolate themselves from the world which was outside. Okay, so yes, of course, Blind Assassin is a very important work of Margaret Atwood Immer. You're absolutely right. So what we'll do is see what you have to remember up until now. What are the major things that we have looked at when we were talking about Canadian writings? I will repeat those things very, very quickly. Please pay attention. And we will, of course, continue from here itself. Okay, we will, of course, continue from here itself. Now, the most important themes that you have to remember, Canada is a multicultural society. Canada is a multicultural society. It was the first ever society to respect multiculturalism and it introduced the Multicultural Act. Canada is having garrison mentality. Garrison mentality is that you create walls around you so that no one can influence you. So that no one can influence you and therefore you're creating walls around you. Garrison mentality, Gunjan, is a mentality just like, you know, when you are at the battlefield, you have these garrisons around you which protect you from any bullet attack, those boris which are there, right? They protect you from any sort of a bullet attack that you will have. So when you talk about the garrison mentality, that is when you create this wall around you so that you don't allow people to influence you. When you create a wall around you so that you don't allow people to influence you. We will actually continue in the next class from this part itself of garrison mentality. And still, if you have any doubts, please do ask. Vandana, you can say that. Okay, Sushmita, I will share. Sushmita is asking for the PDF of Pramod K. Nair's book. I will share that. Don't worry. Okay. Sushmita, if you could write me a doubt, that will remind me to send the PDF version of Pramod K. Nair on the Telegram group and I will send it. Okay. Okay, due to paucity of time then, let's just stop it over here and we will, like I said, continue from here itself. Please take a look at the PDF. I will share the PDF with all of you and I will try to add some more details so that all of you will get a better idea. So Anki is asking, what is a frontier novel? Anki, frontier novel is a novel. Yes, Maitri, we will have. Don't worry. Frontier novel is a novel that is trying to tell you about the battle that the native population was having in order to save themselves from the colonizers. And America was a frontier nation. Frontier nation, that means a huge border. That is like, you know, literally on road you can travel via that border. Okay, we will continue from here and we will also complete all your writers who are associated with this age. And still, if you have any problem, please come on the Grade Up Studio platform, post it in the doubts column, just revise the most important themes that we've discussed for today. And still, if you have any concerns, do keep me posted. Take care. I will see you guys tomorrow. God bless. Bye. And some of you classroom students, I'm seeing you at 8 o'clock itself. All right. Bye.